the Western Door Paranormal Studies. My name is Tony Burtis, founder and lead investigator, and this is Supernatural Zor Valley in Gowanda, New York. Now, Zor Valley itself is a very beautiful place. It's a powerful place, and I recommend, of course, going. I don't necessarily recommend going by yourself, although that can be done. I recommend going with some friends so you can all keep an eye on each other. Now, Zor Valley, by its very nature and its very terrain, is a very, very dangerous place to go. The trails are very narrow, and the drops are sudden and very sheer. Now, for reasons that are obvious, never ever traverse around Zor Valley at night, and never ever drink and decide it's a good idea to start walking around the trails of Zor Valley, because if you're in an altered state and if it's dark, it's not very hard to get turned around. And from my experience walking the trails in Zor Valley, I can see where it'd be very easy to meet an untimely end, especially if it gets dark and you get turned around. You can't see your hand in front of you, and it would be very easy to fall off a cliff, which would explain how many hikers disappear and how many hikers plunge to their death. Now, although Zor Valley is a place to go find oneself for sure, for reasons of safety and for the reasons of capturing evidence, I'm not going into this alone. I'm actually going in with a small team. My investigator in training, Nick Feliciano, is going to be accompanying me, as well as my wife, Felina. Hopefully between the three of us, we can capture evidence of hauntings in Zor Valley, plus we could also be able to possibly catch some personal experiences, because three heads are certainly better than of this exercise, other than the actual cameras that we're going to be using and photography and voice recorders, I'm going to be running these two particular pieces of paranormal gear. This one here is an EMF meter, and this one here is a ghost meter. I'm actually running both of these types of gear because they are massive. It spans Cattaraugus Creek and has a lot of gorges. For the purpose of this particular investigation, we're going to be concentrating on the Valentine Flats area, as where that is the area where there has been a lot of reports of paranormal activity. Now, probably one of the most legendary stories to come out of Zor Valley is the story of the Clawfoot people.
In the late 19th and 20th centuries, many of the inhabitants of Zor Valley were descendants of the same woman, a prostitute who settled in the area in the 1800s. All the descendants were known for their appearance. They were the Clawfoot people. The prostitute was exposed to syphilis and passed the abnormality amongst the town's residents. They were shunned and became outsiders. The condition had severe effects on the family. One man used an axe to remove his deformed fingers. Another, who was not affected by the condition, went on to marry, never telling his spouse about his family history. Their first son was born with the affliction. His wife promptly divorced him. In the 1920s, the Clawfoot people made a pact to never have children in order to eliminate themselves. It was very successful.
Now, Zor Valley is more than just one of Western New York's most haunted places. It's also a known place of power. Now, there are many places in Western New York that are known power places. Niagara Falls, Letchworth State Park, Gutelberg Cemetery, just to name a few. The Native Americans certainly viewed Zor Valley as a place of power and a place to commune with the spirits. Now, many people for years upon years have went down there and actually convened and met there and communed with nature. People of many different faiths has met there and did meditations, prayer, and the such. And I can see where Zor Valley would certainly not only be a place to find a spirit or two, it would be a place to actually find the Great Spirit. Or whatever deity that you pray to, it's almost certain that you can go there and go into deep meditation and take in the forest and the surroundings and actually commune and actually do a lot of meditative healing there. There's actually somebody beyond that rise there. I'm not going to go that far out into it, but there's somebody sitting over there on the other side of that. What, they call these daredevil trees. These the daredevil trees are the ones that let the girl out of the rock face and just kind of hang there precariously, but just never fall. There's one. And there's another daredevil tree kind of just like sitting right out there. That almost have to give the daredevil designation to any tree that wants to grow along this. Now, the one device that Nick was holding is a basic EMF meter. It reads electromagnetic fields. Now, I had that because it has a digital readout and you could actually read and see if there are electromagnetic spikes. I also had my ghost meter, which does the same thing, but there's lights and there's an audio alarm. Now, my ghost meter didn't produce anything. But several times during a walk along the trail, Nick's meter, the EMF meter, inexplicably would spike every now and then. Now to me, that means he was running into pockets of energy. Were they spirit energy or were they earth energies? That I don't know for sure, but it's actually still pretty cool.
Jumps to
1.5.
1.5? Then again to
1.3. That's actually quite the spike. It's not surprising that there'd be a spike like that up here.
Come on, where'd you go?
Is that the place that would be sitting wearing something named trip jeans? Point four.
Yeah. 1.5.
Don't go backward too bad.
1.5 came back, then went 3.4.
Come on. Now is it me, or that other hiker guy just kind of appear out of nowhere? Now, there are a lot of paranormal stories that certainly come out of Zor Valley. The Native Americans that went there certainly had their share. They talked about the Great Serpent and the Great Spirit and talking animals and such. They also talked about the little people that almost certainly abounded in the area. Now, there also have been a lot of UFO stories that come out of Zor Valley. And of course, one of the main stories that come out of Zor Valley are the ghost stories, and most of the ghost stories seem to center around lost hikers. Now, the term lost hiker generally is referring to someone who went into the valley and straight up never came back. For one reason or the other, they seem to have met their demise. Whether they got turned around and fell off the sheer cliff, or somehow were in there after hours when it was dark and were wandering around looking for a way out, and suddenly plummeted to their doom. Now, there's a distinct reason why I chose the Valentine Flats area to do my investigation, because I heard a really good ghost story come out, and it was about the Valentine Flats area. There was some hikers that were in the area and they got turned around. Now, they were faced with the prospect of being lost. Suddenly, a hiker shows up in a tie-dye shirt and in an excited manner, begins to get the hikers to follow them because he knows the way out. Of course, faced with the idea of being lost in Zor Valley, the hikers follow the fellow out. Now, they get to a sheer cliff, and just out of nowhere, this hiker scales the cliff Spider-Man style and completely disappears. Of course, this left the other two hikers completely shooken up, and eventually they found their way out of Zor Valley. And they also had themselves a pretty good paranormal story to tell. Now, of course, when we were hiking the trails, we had the video cameras rolling as another way of documenting evidence of paranormal activity. One of the most common bits of evidence I've been getting with video cameras is called the VVP, which stands for video voice phenomena. It's exactly like an EVP, but you're getting a disembodied voice on a video recording device. Now, one thing that's actually pretty common when it comes to investigating is having voices kind of drop in during normal conversation. And this is what happens here. Now, I can't make out what the voice is saying, but we definitely get a voice that's talking pretty much over and behind me and Felina as we have a discussion.
So how long did this take?
10 minutes to get to the end of this trail.
That's a long...
Wow, look at that.
Yeah, I'm kind of worried about that.
Now, there was a time during the investigation when the wife became exhausted. And it's easy to see because the trails are lengthy and the terrain is up and down. And it does take a lot out of you to walk these trails. Now, at one point, I had her go back to the car to rest. Now, she happened to have my digital voice recorder on her that we use to capture EVPs. Now, EVP stands for electronic voice phenomena, which basically means you're capturing a disembodied voice on a recording device. Now, she got back to the car and she was generally by herself with the exception of a few people going to their vehicles every now and then. She put the voice recorder on the hood of the car and we captured a pretty amazing EVP. Now, I asked her if anyone was around at the time or if she heard anything and she said no. Now, the EVP produced is a Class A EVP and it distinctly says, "Help me." This next series of clips, is it evidence? Is it truly evidence of a ghost, or is it just something that we straight up overlooked? You know, at the end of the day, I'm still not sure, and usually in the paranormal field, when in doubt, throw it out. But there's enough circumstances that come together with this next several little tiny pieces of footage that I just can't bring myself to throw out. Now, don't get me wrong. I am absolutely not saying that this following clip is indeed paranormal in nature. So, once Felina went back to the car, me and Nick were walking the trail that leads up to the overlook. Now, the trail that leads up to the overlook, as I noticed when I reviewed my footage, is pretty night and day. On your left, it's a drop-off. On the right, it's a drop-off. Now, the whole thing kind of tapers. As you're walking straight or even to the one side, you'll notice you can have a pretty clear field of vision to the end point of the walk. Now, the end point of the walk is a sheer drop-off. There is nowhere anyone can actually come up from that point without clearly being seen. And there's really no way from where we were walking to the trail that we would have missed another hiker or somebody kind of hovering out and hanging out right there. So Nick and I actually make it almost to the main point, the main prefaces of this whole thing. And I'm doing my footage of the scenery of the drop-off, and Nick is actually with me. And I look to my right, and standing next to me is a hiker. Now, could this be someone that was just well hidden? It could be. And if anyone recognizes this fellow who's watching this, who's in my area, please definitely feel free to let me know who this fellow is. But I look at him and he kind of just like appears out of nowhere. I didn't see him appear out of nowhere, but when I look to my right, He was just straight up there. I even acknowledge him and he acknowledges me back. And he shows up for a few minutes in a few subsequent clips. And then me and Nick kind of go our own way. And we look in that area and there's simply no one there. And on the way to point B, me and Nick don't see a sign of him. And I ask the wife if she's seen anyone that matches that description actually coming back to the cars. And it seems like, at least in her vantage point, no one did. Now, this could have been someone that was well hidden, but hidden where? I'm including this just in case, because if it was a spirit, I don't want this phenomenal piece of evidence to go away. Now, based on some of the footage you'll see of the terrain, you'll see what I'm talking about when Nick and I actually had a real clear vantage point of from the trail all the way up to where there's nowhere else to go. And the fellow kind of appears behind us. It's my opinion that we would have seen someone milling around on the way to that vantage point. Again, I'm not saying it's paranormal, but I'm including video footage of this fellow just in case. Because one of the big claims in the area, other than Native Americans and such, is lost hitchhikers, people who have actually plummeted to their deaths. Now, is this one of those hitchhikers? I don't know. It could have been just a normal person. But I'm including it just in case. So I just want you to take everything I said into account and just check out. Overall, Soar Valley was an amazing place to visit. The trails were definitely treacherous, but they were really fun to be able to walk. The swimming holes also down there at the base seems like they are a lot of fun, as we witnessed kayakers and people in swimming suits coming up from the area where the creek itself was. And of course, when you went the other direction, the view was breathtaking, although it was also very dangerous. Once again, I'm going to reiterate, if you go, make sure you're out of there before dark. And it's always a good idea to bring somebody with you. Now, as far as evidence of the paranormal goes, yes, we got a really good EVP. Yes, we got a very good VVP. And I still have trouble explaining the hike. So, all in all, Soar Valley lived up to its reputation, in my opinion, of being not only a very beautiful place to visit, but also teeming with spirits.